Professor Moore, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen. I come from across Empire Street. I'm from the other university. Thank you. Say welcome back. Thank you very much. Welcome to you all. My name is Chris Landsberg. I don't know much about economics. I think this is an attempt by Lionel to expose me. But I must say that it's indeed an honor. It's a privilege to be asked to facilitate the first in what is hopefully going to become a regular feature that will be taken throughout the country, an economic policy dialogue. I suspect that one of the reasons why I was asked to facilitate tonight's engagement is that I do not hesitate to put a particular challenge to a South African audience. I remain baffled by our lack of engagement in the country, our lack of transcending narrow positions, sit down, talk to each other in open and frank manners, engaging one another without co-opting each other. And I have a sense that this economic policy dialogue is intended to try and just break through some of the mutual suspicion sometimes, the love-hate relationship between those outside government, those inside government. So I want to put a challenge to us all that we try and do just that tonight, that we engage. I think we have three very eminent, very well-equipped speakers to address the topic of the possible effects of the Eurozone crisis on the South African economy. So I certainly, without having seen any of the presentations, expect to hear a lot about bricks and pigs. Portugal, Italy, Ireland, the one who voted yesterday, Greece, and the one that Messi and Ronaldo is from, scoring all their goals. So we're going to hear a lot about bricks and pigs. But I also have a sense that maybe there's an underlying agenda for us South Africans to talk about the challenges, to use this as an opportunity to talk about our own economic challenges, how we respond to this global crisis. So our three guests tonight, it is my honor to present to you. Our first speaker tonight will be the Director General of the Department of Trade and Industry, Mr. Lionel October. Welcome, DG, and thank you for starting this important initiative. Following the DG will be Mr. Goolam Ballim, Chief Economist and Global Head of Research at Standard Bank. And then I would like us to please bestow a round of applause, a warm round of applause, all the way from the UK, from Cambridge University, the light blues, as we would like to refer to them, Professor Gabriel Palma. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Palma. Just two sets of house rules, and then I'll ask the DG to kick us off. First, Professor Palma really needs about 50 minutes to talk us through his well-prepared, detailed presentation and challenge us, hopefully provoke us in the process. So we'll have the DG going first, followed by Goolam, and then I'll introduce, and then I'll ask Professor to come You will see on your table, finally, just for now, a bit of house rules. There's an evaluation form, a very short and concise one. If you don't mind filling it in, if you want to say it's excellent already, please proceed. If you want to wait until after the engagement, you're also welcome to do that. Ladies and gentlemen, 9 October.
Thanks. Thank you, Chris, and thank you for being the master of ceremonies for guiding us through this process. I just want to make a few remarks about this economic dialogue and why BTI has embarked on this program with Wits. As you know, I think apart from the fact that our discourse around development issues, around economic issues, apart from the fact, as Chris mentioned, it's adversarial, and but really, besides being adversarial, I think it's also very superficial, and there's a lot of, it's usually a sort of a blame game. Different constituencies, different actors within the economic sphere are blamed for the crisis or for the problem and so on. And I think what we think we want to introduce now is really a more rational discourse on the economic challenges. And that's why we're not calling it a lecture series, even though we do have an eminent professor here to kick us off. We're not dealing with lectures. We've called it a dialogue. And a dialogue means it's a process of engagement. It's a point of, for a moment, suspending your very strongly held beliefs, listening, and then, as I said, trying to respond and trying to come to some sort of a common understanding. And so we are going to, as DTI, we're going to hope to run this series once a quarter in different places and so on, but we hope it could become a forum for us. So thank you, all of you, my colleagues from government, business, trade unions, students, academics, the media. Really, thank you for coming this evening and kickstarting this process. And as I said, we hope that this can become an area for us to debate some of the serious issues facing us. Now, let me just quickly turn to the topic. And as I said, Professor Palma is really has got a big range of experience in all the areas of economics, development economics, and really he's going to be the main exposition. I want to just make a few comments on it from DTI side. Now, in the last, let's say when the last financial crisis hit 3-4 years ago, South Africa's economy, we lost 1 million jobs. The biggest proportion of those jobs, or a disproportionate amount, was in the manufacturing sector. So we had a bloodbath. So we were completely unprepared for the crisis and its effects, even though NEDLAC had hundreds of debating sessions and so on. But the end result of all our deliberations was job losses of 1 million rand. So this time around, it is clear that our exposure as an economy, it is our the European Union, is the bulk of our manufactured exports goes. It's not our biggest trading partner anymore, but it's the biggest trading partner for manufactured exports. And clearly, we need to be prepared if there's going to be either a serious downturn, or even if there's just stagnation. I think we must be prepared as an economy for that. Now, I think there will be debate, and Goolam will take us through it, but I think what we want to get out of today's session is to understand some of the fundamental causes of the Eurozone crisis. And as I said, move beyond the blaming lazy Greeks or austere Germans or anything like that. We want to understand what is the fundamental cause of that crisis. And as I said, we've been working through some of these issues, but one thing we want to throw into the discussion is that maybe the solution doesn't lie just where the problems are. Maybe to find a solution, we must find is, why is there differential performance within the Eurozone? Why are some countries like Germany, Finland, Netherlands, Sweden, others, why are they performing well? And some are dragging down the Eurozone. And we're saying the one differentiator of all the countries that are succeeding and those who are failing is those who have maintained and strengthened their industrial base and their industrial capacity. Those who are running a trade surplus are the ones who are surviving. The ones who are falling are those with trade deficits and with where deindustrialization has happened. So the issue we want to throw in when we prepare for this response is that we want to engage and debate this issue, but we're saying that if that is a correct analysis, then we must ensure in this coming stagnation in our main trading partner, we must come up with a response which says, how do we preserve, protect, develop, sustain our industrial base, and especially our productive sectors of agriculture, mining, and industry. But that should be, we must have a coherent response this time so to ensure that we don't, as I said, suffer such a knock as we did in the last round. So I think with those remarks, I'm going to just leave you with that issue. But as I said, really we will be hosting these sessions once a quarter, hopefully developing more and more difficult topics, which we hope to introduce. The issue of rising inequality in our economy, the issue of the exchange rate, its impact on the economy, and many other issues. Labor costs in the economy, is it the main problem or not, and so on. But those are the issues we will get to, but I think this is the start of the series. Thank you.
So sometimes, irrespective of whether you're the first act, second, or last, you know you're not the main act. And tonight, I'm that guy. But that's okay, because there's less pressure on me to boil the ocean tonight. I'm also thrown a little bit because I misunderstood and I thought I would be following Dr. Palma, which would have meant that I could ascribe all of my thoughts to what you had heard preceding, almost word for word, exhibit for exhibit. But now I'm compelled to be a little bit more agile and to be novel. Alternatively, I'm just going to have to make stuff up. On balance, though, when I look around this room, I can safely say that for the most part, there's smart people here, which means that I'm probably not going to get away with the latter part. So let me also say thank you to the Department of Trade and Industry and also Wits University for organizing this occasion and for affording me an opportunity to share a platform with you. As you will have noted from the paraphernalia in front of you, I am a product of Wits University, so I can safely say that any embarrassment that I heap upon myself can safely and disproportionately be shared with the university. So having dispensed with the gratitude, the pleasantries, the disclaimer, and the veiled insults, let me begin to get on to the topic that we are to address. In some respects, we can say that this is just another recession. We've had 120 episodes over the last 50 years of recession occurrences, and by now we should know a fair quantity of what these things look like and how we potentially can respond. But great economics over above good economics is recognizing that economics needs to be understood in terms of its time, where in economic history we are, and what unique conditions is presented by that ecosystem and how we need to take cognizance of that. It's about 4 years since Lehman Brothers filed for bankruptcy. And the enormity, the longevity of this costly exercise has been brought to the fore. More than 30 million people around the world have lost access to secure incomes. Probably more than that, function in an environment where they are insecure about their jobs, and everybody has been impacted. I think it's within that context that it's helpful to understand the nature, the roots of the current recession and the great crisis that we're experiencing. There's probably a variety of causes that we can identify, but I'm loosely just going to highlight four. The first, quite simply, relates to a very high level of indebtedness, particularly amongst those so-called rich or developed economies. So Kenneth Rogoff and Carmen Reinhardt looked at 800 years of recessionary experience, and they tell us that when the debt-to-GDP ratio with respect to public sector indebtedness rises above 90%, typically bad things happen. If we look at the United States and Japan, the United Kingdom, France, Greece, Portugal, Ireland, and Spain, these economies have public sector indebtedness that range from 90% to as much as 240%. And of course, if you layer that with household indebtedness, as well as non-financial public sector debt, then in the aggregate, these economies that I've just mentioned have a total stock of debt 3.5 times the size of the aggregate GDP. So in an environment with this quantity of leverage, clearly sustainability in terms of their credit worthiness is brought to the fore. A second element that I would bother to mention, and this has lingered for some time, not just related to recent events, relates to trading imbalances. So some economies do have net surpluses on their trading accounts. Those are symptoms. They're symptoms of their innate level of competitiveness in their economies. But we've called for a length of time for those net exporting economies to consume more, to import more, to save less. And on the other hand, those net deficit countries in terms of their trading accounts to save more, become more competitive, to look to allow their industrial endeavors to allow them to penetrate foreign markets. The reality, though, is that this recalibration is unlikely to happen soon. Now, I've alluded to competitiveness. If one looks at, for instance, that grouping of economies, Greece, Ireland, Portugal for that matter, and Spain, one will note that over the last decade, unit labor costs in those economies have risen by between 25 and 35%. However, if you look at that other dynamic economy, Germany, unit labor costs through much of the last decade actually declined, and only very recently has begun to rise somewhat. But in Germany today, unit labor costs are about the same as they were in 2000. The fourth element that I would bother to mention that perhaps speaks to the root of the crisis relates to an aging population in the developed world and principally in Europe. And this is alongside a shrinking workforce. So the median age of an African, for instance, is about 19 years old. That of an Asian is 30 years old. That of a European, 40 years old. And simultaneously, the workforce in Europe is shrinking. Over the next decade, by 2.5%, and by 2050, Europe's workforce is in all likelihood, likely to have shrunk by 15%. Given the welfare state nature of that economy, a rising dependency ratio, and present day high levels of indebtedness, this is a fiscal smash that could continue for a great length of time. So those are perhaps the four items that I will inject as providing roots to the current challenges. That is a global challenge. But there's also some lessons that I would suggest we can glean specifically from this episode of crisis. And also here, I want to mention four things. The The first two are probably lessons that we gleaned overwhelmingly from the US downturn. Let's call it the first installment of this rather slow motion crash. And then there's a further two items that I will take from Europe. The first relates to what economists call network externalities. Of course, we dream up these sophisticated terms just to give some veneer of elegance and craft to what we do. Most of you will think about this as globalization, but simply being wired. The great miscalculation of this recent episode is we failed to understand the manner in which the world had become a village, had become joined. The manner in which goods, services, and money over the last 40 years had become so much more fluid across the planet. And also how these channels intermingle. The manner in which the financial sector channel can impact on the real economy channel, and the manner in which the activities in the real economy can feed back into financial sector health. So this minor little problem of some level of delinquencies in mortgage repayments in the United States dented the United States financial system, which caused their credit system to convulse, causing their economy to slip into recession, and then the US economy exported its woes to the rest of the world. And suddenly, in the fourth quarter of 2008, 30 million workers in the Guangdong province of Asia, of China, lost their jobs. And in 2009, 1 million souls lose formal employ in South Africa. And somewhere in that is the manner in which network externalities is brought to bear. The second lesson that we can glean from the earliest phase of this crisis is the extent of imperfect, incomplete information that market participants have. And this alludes to the idea that, whether it's the financial sector or even the real economy, the manner in which they judged their situation, say in 2006 and 7, 2008, was imperfect, meaning that they miscalculated the risks, they mispriced for those risks. And so the allocation of resources, be it capital or just simply human energy, was misdirected because the price incentives were incorrect. The market was inefficient. The market was not calibrating appropriately. The two lessons that I would draw from the more recent experience out of Europe is to contrast two economies. An economy where the work ethic is absent, that enjoys subsidy from its neighbors, that lacks sound political and economic governance, that is inept in the most basic of government functions, like collecting revenue. And the last time they exported anything of great significance, it was the allure of a Shirley Valentine romance. But yesterday's result will suggest that they've also realized that anger is not a policy, and denial can only delay the day of reckoning. But while we find it easy to simply dismiss that nation, it's interesting to note that that nation was competitive just before they joined the euro. It is over the last 10 years that Greece's competitiveness evaporated, and this probably a lesson in that as well. Then, of course, there is that other economy that has a fine covenant between business, labor, and government, that has potent export brands and a global distribution network, that has managed its monetary policy very robustly, and reasonably so in terms of fiscal policy. That country that has the highest number of possible points in the Euro 2012 contest. Now the cynics in the room will probably tell me, but Greece made it to the quarterfinals as well. And I'll tell you that they beat Russia. Where the great lesson from Russia is the president has been able to simply bypass the inconvenience of two-term limits. and swap between prime minister and president and prime minister and president. So one wonders if that really comes. And if you really doubt my model, that unit labor cost that is lower will triumph, I urge you to bet the result of Friday's game where Germany will challenge Greece. I am sure you will be chicken. There's lessons in what I've mentioned. There's lessons in what it suggests, the type of economy we should be and what we aspire to. In the 1990s, we threw our arms around universal suffrage, and we also threw our arms around the world. We liberalized the current account of the balance of payments, and more slowly, the capital account, the financial account of our balance of payments. Effectively, what that meant is that with time and increasingly, we would be subject to the whims of the global tide, rising and subsiding along with it. Just before Lehman Brothers collapse, the export to GDP ratio in South Africa rose to a cyclical high of 38%. That would suggest an exceedingly open economy, an exceedingly exposed economy. Of course, helpful in benign global times, but treacherous during more challenging occasions. In 2009, its economy contracted by 1.5%. Some would suggest that it was not as bad as 1992, when the economy contracted by 2.1%. And by that measure, they would suggest that this contraction, this episode, is the worst in about two decades. And I think that is wrong. If one considers that the momentum changed to a contraction of 1.5% from a period of growth in excess of 5% per year in the 5 years to 2007, with respect to the pace of change in, say, the growth of national income, national output, or even household income, the current episode is the worst since the Second World War. And in the aggregate, the loss in momentum is about twice that of the garden variety recession over the last 50 years or so. Put slightly differently and conservatively, we estimate that foregone income in the 4 years to 2011 amounts to a cumulative 500 billion rand. Reducing it a little bit more simply, that's the equivalent of foregone income amounting to 20,000 rand for every South African adult of working age. Recessions are costly. Now, I'd like to present some policy suggestions. This is, after all, what I think this gathering is about. And if you will grant me the liberty, I'd like to judge it through the lens of South Africa's external dynamic, its export or external trading framework. I think there are enough lessons to be learned from this, and it's very applicable to South Africa's internal growth dynamic. So I'd ask you to consider the following. Over the last 10 years, South Africa's trade with the rest of Africa has surged from approximately 70 billion rand to roughly 220 billion rand, a threefold increase. At the same time, South Africa runs a surplus with the rest of Africa of approximately 40 billion rand, if you exclude the SECU countries, the South Africa Customs Union countries. But if you include that category of economies, we run a surplus of 100 billion rand. And that contrasts with a deficit of approximately 68 billion rand in 2011 with Asia, and a deficit of 61 billion rand with Europe. It's clear that we seem to have some advantage and some scope for value add. And on the scope of value add with respect to our trade with the rest of Africa, roughly one third comprises an assortment of machinery and capital equipment. Another one tenth is prepared foodstuffs. And a further one tenth is in the realm of semi-durable goods items. So just on that score, roughly half of our shipments to the rest of the continent can be seen to be drawn from the industrial sector, where we are price makers rather than price takers, where there is value add. In contrast, approximately 85 to 90% of our products shipped to Asia is resources. So the share of value added is comparatively smaller and where we are price takers. So on all of these measures, Africa seems to have provided enormous growth. And in concert with Africa's rise, we have participated. But that would be celebrating perhaps a little bit too soon. I want to highlight now some of the challenges or the failures with respect to our Africa position. The first point is Africa, South Africa does not trade sufficiently with the rest of Africa. In 2005, South Africa exported to the rest of the continent as much as China did. Today, China exports twice as much to the rest of the continent as we do. $35 billion of product more than we do. In the last decade, China's exports to the continent has grown tenfold. Over the last decade, South Africa's exports to the rest of the continent has grown threefold. So I would suggest we do not trade enough with the continent, and in line with the continent's opportunity, while we seem to celebrate some gains, it's actually trivial. The second element relates to the arc of markets with which South Africa trades. Approximately 85% of South Africa's trade is with the SADC economies. So 85% of product goes to economies that in the rest of the continent account for roughly 17% of GDP. Of course, I exclude South Africa. We have no African footprint of substance beyond our very near neighbors. We have no meaningful relationships in terms of trade with Africa's top 10 largest economies. If you would have factored from my earlier statements, what I'm basically also saying is that approximately 1/10 of South Africa's exports go to the continent's top 10 largest economies. That account for 75% of the continent's GDP. We ship about 4% of our exports to Nigeria. It's a minuscule few percent to Ghana. It's less than 1% to Egypt. Kenya, not very far, takes in a mere 5% of its total imports from South Africa. The third lesson that we can learn from Africa is the quality of our diplomacy. Our foreign relations that is state-led. Under the President Mbeki regime, of course, Africa was a significant touchstone in terms of foreign policy. But for the most part, in my judgment, it related to establishing political court and political connections. There was discord in terms of what the commercial agenda could be or should be. Under the incumbent president's reign, I would assert, too, that we've been myopic. President Zuma has visited Africa in terms of state missions 7 times. On 5 occasions, it's been to SADC countries, and the other 2 occasions, it's been to Uganda and Egypt. No state visits to Nigeria, no state visits to the high potential countries like Ethiopia. Instead, we celebrated going to Sanaa to break bread with the BRICS counterparts, while those breaking bread with us were breaking ground on the rest of the continent. So with those 3 notions to judge how South Africa is engaged with the rest of the continent, let me make a few policy suggestions. I think we should put Africa at the center of our foreign affairs endeavor. We should strengthen the ties with the SADC nations, and we should seek to concertedly build bridges with those non-SADC economies, with the larger economies on the continent. That much vaunted free trade alliance involving the Eastern Community, COMESA, and SADC is something that should be given very vibrant impetus. The second policy suggestion relates to our gateway status. following my recent remarks, it's quite clear we do not have the capacity to provide consistent access to firms using South Africa as a springboard for their Africa inspirations and aspirations. What we can do, of course, is provide substance for those markets where we do have vibrant cores and realize those markets where we were absent and attempt to build substantial endeavor in that respect. The third element is that we need a focused commercial strategy. For much of our recent past, the disconnect between states' agenda and the private sector's ambitions have been mostly of discord. The private sector and the state-led initiatives on the continent should be.
Thank you.
Well, first, thank you to the BBI and Wits for inviting me here. As some of you know, I'm Chilean national. I live in the UK a bit because of an historical accident. So it's particularly a pleasure for me to come south. Suddenly food began to have taste and things like that. The only thing I hope that, since we're going to talk about the effect of the global crisis in South Africa, I hope that among your traditions, you don't have one of shooting the messenger of bad news. Because I'm afraid it's not going to be a very cheerful presentation. I don't need to go to start saying how bad things are in Europe, particularly. Everybody knows that. I mean, just yesterday came the news that the British exports fell by 10% in the last quarter, mostly due to the almost collapse of export to the European Union. I mean, things are getting really bad. Now, what is the effect of that in countries like South Africa or in Latin America is, of course, a rather complicated affair. One can look at it from many perspectives and many points of view, starting by the obvious one, the current account. You can see that, and as you obviously know, I'm not telling anything new, for reasons which are not entirely obvious, you have had quite a significant deterioration in your current account at the same time in which commodity prices have boomed. I put the line there in 2003, because 2003 was the last year in which commodity prices were sort of as historical levels. And from then onwards, as you know, they have boomed. Now, basically, you have more than adjusted to that price bonanza. And that price bonanza, as everybody who knows anything about economic history knows, that is going to be temporary. Of course, everybody thinks this time is different, but it's not. The only difference this time is that at least half, probably more, of that price bonanza is pure speculation in financial markets. But other than that, we know that this is a temporary state of affairs. Therefore, to more than adjust to that price bonanza obviously puts you in some sort of vulnerable position. And last year, your current account deficit was 3% of GDP, which is nothing dramatic, but it's not mine. Just to give you an indication of how much you have over-adjusted, look at the same current account, but now the green line is exactly the one before, but the red line is what would have been your current account had the terms of trade of South Africa stayed at the level of 2003, which was the sort of historical, the average. I mean, I'm not talking of a collapse of commodity prices. I'm just talking about commodity prices going back to historical levels. We're talking about 6 percentage points of GDP. In other words, your current account today, or last year, would have been 9, the deficit, 9% of GDP, had the commodity prices been at historical level. Now, the point of importance here is that commodity prices can easily come down to their historical levels, let alone to the level of wages. As most of it is about speculation, obviously, you make money only if you get out rather quickly when trends began to move in the opposite direction, meaning the adjustment, I'm not saying it's going to happen soon. What I'm saying is that when it happens, it can happen very quickly. And if it happens very quickly, and you're saddled with that kind of current account position, the domestic adjustment could be rather brutal. Now, I know you have a few reserves in your central bank, 50 billion, but I mean, Brazil has 350 billion. And the other BRICS are obviously in figures much larger than that. So your capacity to withstand a rather quick adjustment in commodity prices is not that great. And the adjustment, as you can see, it could be rather large, okay? So from the point of view of the current account, there is a vulnerability there which obviously is quite substantial. And as I said, what is odd is that it took place at the same time of the commodity boom. So you over-adjusted to that. Now, part of the story, of course, is that your export performance in the last 10 years have been rather disappointing. There was quite a significant recovery of exports after 94, between 94 and 2000. But in the last 10 years, exports as a share of GDP has remained sort of in a typical cyclical way, more or less stable. With last year in a position where it's in the below to 2000. Now, one of the crucial reasons for that is for somebody who comes from somewhere else, I mean, not for a South African, I mean, I do follow the South African economy rather closely, but obviously not as close as Brazil or Chile or whatever. So for me, it's somehow surprising the particularly disappointing performance of your mining sector, especially at a time where commodity prices were booming. This graph, which I took from Nimrod's presentation in our place, it shows that the South African growth between 2001 and 2008 is actually non-existent. I mean, it's actually slightly negative. While in the case of Chile, my country is 12%, and well, China, of course, that's one expect distance of China. It's almost one should not even take it that seriously. They belong to a different planet. Anyway, but other commodity producing countries, with the exception of South Africa, that had their mining sector performing much better during this period. So, on the trade account, the deterioration is, and the relatively weak performance is more or less obvious. But so far, of course, you have been able to count on your capital accounts to sort out the problem. But as everybody knows, capital accounts are particularly erratic and particularly unpredictable. And most of all, it moves from reasons which often have very little to do with South Africa, or Chile, or Brazil. The only thing one could say is that the instability of, for example, your portfolio inflows, although large, have nothing to do with the remarkable instability that we have had in Latin America with portfolio inflows. I mean, in Latin America, in 1989-90, the famous Brady Bonds Agreement, which meant that the inflows returned to the region, we moved from 0 to 125, 0 to 75, negative 100, negative 125. I mean, it's not a very reliable partner if this was possible. I mean, it's a very, very risky factor to be so dependent on. It's, it's what kind of exchange rate policy can you follow if you have your capital account open? What sort of monetary policy? I mean, it's obviously the answer to this is capital controls, which I'm not going to go into detail since I'm talking tomorrow here at BITS, if anybody has the patience to listen it to me again. I'm talking tomorrow exactly on capital controls here. But these kind of things, this kind of external instability, it really opens to question the degree of openness of the capital account that we have in Latin America and that you have here in South Africa. I mean, does it make sense to have this kind of instability shocking your economy so systematically? It's obviously, the answer is no. I mean, I am not very, very sort of in favor of inflation targeting and all the rest of this typical monetary macro, but you have to take a bit of pity of people who have to work in a central bank in a capital account open country and be faced with this sort of, I mean, this basically, inflation targeting and flexible exchange rate is nothing else than throwing in the towel. What are you going to do with this? Basically, you throw in the towels and allow markets to find their own adjustment. And obviously, the adjustment in Latin America is that Brazil has the most overvalued exchange rate in the world, according to Goldman Sachs, followed very closely by Chile, my country. And of course, that has decimated domestic manufacturing. It has had incredibly negative effects. But if you are going to have your open capital account, and this is a sort of flows that you, shocks that you are faced, it's a rather difficult policy to do anything else. So obviously, first best policy is do something at all. But also, there is something that is really interesting about capital inflows. Because everybody talks about FDI as the sort of Mother Teresa of economics. I mean, everything wonderful, positive. That in Latin America, it's even worse than here. I mean, in Latin America, no matter what problem we have, FDI is the solution. Well, since the Brady Bonds in Latin America, we have had $1.8 trillion worth of FDI in today's money, meaning the area there is $1.8 trillion. It's the largest per capita in the world, the largest per unit of GDP in the world, no matter what you look at it, no matter how you normalize it, it's the largest in the world. And look at our investment rate. Today is exactly what it was at the Brady Bonds, and much lower than what it was in the 70s, which was not very high to start with. $1.8 trillion worth of FDI have had no effect on domestic investment. I mean, it's almost, I mean, you have to try hard to achieve that. Of course, most of it is mergers, acquisition, and all, but has nothing, no direct positive impact. So one of the key things that we have to learn about this crisis, I mean, about the rethinking of economic policy and about rethinking about economic strategies, is that this openness of capital accounts and such dependence on foreign inflows, at best, is doubtful in the case of FDI, and at worst, is very damaging in the case of portfolio. I'm not arguing against FDI. It's not an argument against. When I propose capital controls, I don't mean to control FDI. But what I do mean is that unless the effort comes from at home, I don't think it's, I mean, you cannot expect that FDI is going to do what you are unable or willing to do. I mean, just think, $1.8 trillion. We're talking about large numbers, I think. No impact on domestic investment, whatever. Now, the other thing about the effect of the crisis in South Africa that you have to be really concerned, and this is a very important point. Be very careful, be very aware, very suspicious of the lessons that most people are taking, policymakers, economists, and so on, are taking from this crisis. I mean, if some Martian were to arrive upon Earth and start reading financial press, we'll be forgiven for thinking that this is all about Greece and Italy, I mean, public sectors which are totally irresponsible and things like that. This crisis, it really hits the heart of the whole neoliberal thinking, the whole Washington consensus thinking, the whole way of dealing with economic policy and economic strategy that has been so dominant in the world economy since Thatcher and Reagan. And in this sense, I want to differentiate very clearly three stages of the thinking. The first one, I really am surprised when everybody talks and continues to talk that why nobody predicted this crisis? Why was it so difficult to predict? Now, I honestly don't take much claim. I don't feel that special for having been one of the very few economists who, on writing, predicted this crisis. Because when you look at the numbers, it was obvious. I mean, this was probably the most predictable crisis that has ever existed. So the key point to start with is in the first cycle of this awareness issue. Why was it that people, policymakers and economists, my profession is just the worst in the world for that. I mean, why was it totally unable to see what it was in front of their own eyes? Psychoanalysts call that mania. I mean, this detachment with reality. Let me give you just a few, because of time, just very few examples. All this is data from the IMF, okay? I have invented it, it was all available. Look at Greece, Ireland, Spain, and Portugal, the countries where most of the problem in Europe takes place at the moment. How many of you knew that in the 5 years before the crisis, the value of the stock of financial assets, meaning the capitalization of the stock markets, private bonds, public bonds and bank assets. Capitalization of stock markets, private bonds, public bonds, and bank assets. Stocks, not flows. Imagine the 31st of December at noon, in that second, what was the value of those four assets? They were growing in Greece at what? 23% per annum, meaning doubling in what, less than 3 years. In Ireland, at 25. In Spain, at what, 27. In Portugal, at what, 17. Now, can anybody tell me what was happening in these economies to justify that the value of the stock of financial assets was doubling every 2 to 3 years? Remember the famous, I'm sure they still teach it here at Wits, we certainly do it in Cambridge, well, I don't, but most people do, the famous efficient capital market theory. The asset prices deserve a pedestal. They always embody every information, public and private, available in the market. Well, what is the information that was there? I mean, what was happening in Greece, for God's sake, in these 5 years, to justify the value of the stock of financial assets growing 5 or 6 times faster than GDP? What was happening in Portugal that was growing 17 times faster than GDP? You can argue, at least in Ireland, something was happening, okay? It doesn't justify that, but at least there was something real. But what was real in Spain? What was real in Greece to justify this? I mean, this is financial markets going completely crazy. I mean, this is basically financial deregulation in over-liquid financial market, making self-regulation and market discipline, making them a joke. I mean, everybody talks today that, yes, public sector debt in Greece is, well, was 120% of GDP, now nobody knows what it is. And 6 years before was, what, 60, 70%. Yes, it wasn't responsible from Greece to follow that. But somebody was lending it. And somebody was lending it very cheaply. And Goldman Sachs was making a lot of money disguising the level of public debt that Greece was acquiring. Okay? If I go to my bank manager and ask $1 million to play the casino, and I lose, yes, it's my fault. But don't come and tell me that why on earth did I could borrow that, because somebody else was lending that money. Okay? If you look at the famous financial debt, Spain, in those 5 years, added something like 2 times its GDP to this value of the stock of financial assets. Twice its whole GDP. Greece, 1.5 times its GDP. Okay? Now, what was happening to those economies to justify that? Nothing. I mean, this is the basic Hindelberger, the basic Minskian, Keynesian idea. I mean, financial markets, on normal circumstances, can kind of sort out their own affairs. But if they are overly and under-regulated, forget it. Okay? This is what you find. And in Africa, you also added 1 GDP. In Latin America, you also added 1 GDP to the stock of value of financial assets, okay? In Latin America, believe me, there was nothing, nothing happening to justify it, nothing. It was simply financial markets running amok. And this is the other statistics, which is the whole world statistic, which, again, IMF data, okay? look at the stock of financial assets as a multiple of world GDP. In 1990, it was one. By the time of the crisis, it was about 4.5 times the value of the world. Remember the Keynesian idea in finance. Finance only work when you link it to the real economy. Every time that link is broke, is broken, you have what we have today. Okay? Look at in dollars terms. By 9/11, the value of the stock of financial assets was about $1.5 trillion. 5 years later, it was $250 trillion. Now, does anybody, can anybody believe that this is sustainable? Under what assumptions can this go on? But how many financial analysts, how many financial journalists, how many economists were saying that this is suicide? Okay? Very few. And even today, Greenspan argues that this is 1 in 100 years event, chance. It's like a tsunami. We know that will happen, but we never know when. Now, does anybody seriously believe that this is sustainable? Obviously not. The level of debt. Look at, in the case of the US, this is just domestic debt, doesn't include foreign debt in the US. Look at the period of the Bretton Woods Agreement. Because often I'm asked the question, what is the essence of financial regulation that works? What is, if for example we have to re-regulate financial market, which we obviously do, what is the, what do you have to have in mind? Well, this is half of the answer. You have to have in mind a financial market that is completely tied to the real economy and that grows accordingly. And you have here a huge period of time in which debt to GDP ratio was stable. There comes Reagan and Thatcher and the deregulation of financial markets, and look what happened. Okay? It's not very difficult. It may be difficult to think the specific policies to do that. But what is the aim? What is the basic idea? It's not very difficult to understand. Again, was this sustainable? How far can it go up? How far can it go up? The level of household debt, corporate debt, government debt, and financial debt. Just to give you one issue about this real world problem. In the period 50-80, in the US, the income of the bottom 90% of the population, leave the top 10 out, okay? The bottom 90. The average income was growing at roughly 3.5%. And their personal consumption was growing as roughly the same. It doesn't mean there is no debt, but it means that both things are sustainable. Both things are moving together. Look what happened in the post-Reagan Thatcher period. The average income of the bottom 90% in the US remained stagnant for the last 30 years. Stagnant for the last 30 years. I mean, all the increase in income has been appropriated by the top 10%. And in fact, by the top 5. You know how during the Clinton period, it was a period of relatively rapid growth. What percentage of additional income was captured by the top 1%? 45%. And during Bush, 75%. 75% of the growth that took place under Bush was appropriated by the top 1. Anyway, back to the bottom 90. The gross income of the bottom 90 grew at 1.8%. Because you have a stagnant average income in growing population. And population growth in the US is 1.8. So the growth of income of the mass of the bottom 90 was growing at 1.8%. But their personal consumption grew at 3.4. Two things, no prices for guessing how to cover the difference. But more important than that, everybody, not everybody, but a lot of people think that all this household debt in the US and UK is always huge. In the US it's 140% of disposable income, in the UK it's 180% of disposable income. So everybody thinks that somehow household in the US, UK, and so went in some sort of consumption spree, in some kind of carnival. No. All what happened is that personal consumption continued to grow at exactly the same rate as before, except that personal income was down. Because one of the key things that we have to understand about neoliberals and about the Washington Consensus and so on, is that type of economy almost inevitably end up to be a very rent-seeking economy. What is what happening here? Here, capital was paying the level of wages that was necessary to sustain the level of effective demand, which was appropriate for capital accumulation. Here, it was part paying, part lending those wages. Because obviously, any process of massive income concentration has the problem of effective demand. You're transferring income from high expenditure, people with high propensity to spend, to people with relatively low propensity to spend on the real economy. Now, that inevitably will produce problem of effective demand. Now, neoliberalism squared the circle by part paying, but lending those wages. In the same way that if you look at the public sector of these countries, public expenditure remained constant as a proportion of GDP. But taxes for the rich were slashed. So the same. Before, the top 10% to get the free public goods, they pay their taxes. Now they part pay, part lend those taxes to the government. Who doesn't want to live in a world like that? Instead of paying the level of wages necessary to sustain effective demand, you part pay, part lend. Instead of paying your taxes to get the free public goods, you part pay, part lend those taxes. The key point is always the same. You can get away with it, but it's not sustainable. Okay? This is basically what we're talking about. And for those of you who are not familiar with this data, look at what's happening with income distribution in the US. The top 1% was getting about 9% when Reagan was elected. By the time of the crisis, it was 24% of GDP. Of course, it was appropriating, as I said, 45% of additional income at the time of Clinton, 75% at the time of Bush. We're basically talking about $4 trillion that hit the top 5% of the US population. Okay? Now, not surprisingly, the financial market became rather liquid, okay? Because obviously, no matter how you try, it's rather difficult to spend such a small group of population to spend $4 trillion, okay? And this is what was happening. Look at the relationship between the value of financial, the stock of financial assets, and the share of income of the top 10%. Fairly stable in the Bretton Woods period, and look how they move together. For those of you who enjoy your econometrics, if this is not cointegration, I don't know what cointegration is about. This is a perfect tango dancing punch. Perfect. Okay? So the issue about this massive deterioration of income distribution in the US and the UK and so on. It's not only a matter of justice, equity, and politics. It's also about economic efficiency. The dynamics that you create in financial market with this sort of income concentration is inevitably really liquid financial markets. And those liquid financial markets is the one who behave in the way they do. Let me give you a very brief personal anecdote. When I bought my first house, my first flat in England in 82, took me 6 months to get a mortgage. I already had a job. I had with my partner a third of the money for the flat, so we were only borrowing 2/3. Took me 6 months to find a mortgage lender who was prepared to lend me. 10 years later, when I bought my second one in Cambridge, took me one telephone call. One telephone call. Now, we have moved from seller's market to buyer's market. The point of Kindleberger is that financial market only works when there are seller's market. The minute there is a buyer's market, forget it. And the story doesn't finish there. In 2004, I got a letter from my mortgage lender saying, when you bought your house, you put half the money, you borrowed the other half, but your house now is worth 6 times more, the absurdity of the boom. So we have opened this credit line for you for £400,000, $800,000 for you to use whenever you like. Now tell that to a Latin. Now, that, how I use it, which I should have if I had any sense in the short-term sense of financial market, because I would pay 5% of that money, and I could put the money in the stock market, which was given 15% per year at that time. So I would have made a very nice difference between the two. But my mortgage would have been $1 million, which there's no way I can afford it. So basically, had I taken it and got it wrong, I would have lost my house. Now, fortunately, the only useful thing for me to understand financial market was that if they're offering me $400,000, there is something seriously wrong going on there. And you better hide, don't get involved. So even my Latin genes were behave for once. Now, the other side of the story of this famous rent-seeking type of story of neoliberalism and Washington consensus and so on is this data. Imagine you were to ask me, tell me in 2 words or in 2 minutes, what is the historical legitimacy of capitalism in a materialistic sense? Why is it legitimate that a system exists in which such a tiny minority appropriates such a huge share of national wealth? And the answer from Marx to Schumpeter to Keynes to Kindleberger is very simple. The historical legitimacy is because that minority not only appropriates such a huge share of national income, but put back into the economy in the form of private investment a substantial proportion of that. And it is that private investment, the one that develops the productive forces of society through investment, technological change, product innovation, and so on. Yeah, but there are two types of capitalism. One is the Latin one, in which private investment is only 1/3 of the share of income of the top 10%. 1/3. The other one is the Asian one. The first year, the second or the third, where between 3/4, and in the case of Korea, 1. Meaning, in Korea, private investment is equal to the full of the share of the top 10. And in most of Asia, it's about 3/4. Now, you will ask me South Africa. I always like to say that South Africa is the honorary Latin American country in Africa. In the same way that the Philippines is the honorary Latin American country in Asia. And you have the same elite. They like to have their cake and eat it. This is the point. I mean, obviously, part of the difference is not just consumption, part of the difference is also financial markets. I mean, surprise, you have very liquid financial markets under those conditions, and not a very effective level of private investment. But the key issue about the US, where we have this data, is that the relationship between private investment and financial assets during the Bretton Woods period, it was hand by hand. This is what Keynes had in mind in Bretton Woods. This is what Roosevelt had in mind in the 30s. How you tie the financial markets to the real economy. Now, what happened after the Reagan-Thatcher revolution? You have a massive explosion in the value of financial assets, and nothing to show in investment. So what happened in the US? The US, up to 1980, was in the 50% level, and now it's back to the Latin 1/3. Okay? So, the whole idea of this financial liberalization being this kind of dynamic process that will unleash all these forces that are there that only needs to be deregulated in order to work and all the rest of it. I'm sorry. I want financial repression, okay? All this data was there. How could people think that this is sustainable? Another example, Tobin Hume, is the relationship between the replacement value of companies and how much stock market will value the company. Imagine General Motors. How much it will cost to replace it today? How much is valued in financial markets? And you expect a long-term trend of one, as what happened before. Of course, there are always cycles, okay? The point here is that there was no self-adjustment mechanism there, okay? We have had videos in which the total Q had gone up. Financial market overpricing assets. But there was something there that brought financial market back to rationality. There was something there that brought financial market back to earth. There was nothing here. Okay, that is the problem with financial deregulation, okay, in our liquid financial market. So, at the end of the story, the first issue that one has to have in mind is that if all the evidence was there, how on earth so few people look at it? Okay? And even today, how so few people argue that these crises were basically, it was one of the most predictable and one of the most deserved crises ever for financial markets, okay? But I think that neoliberalism conquered the world like the Holy Inquisition conquered Spain. Now, suddenly we have Lehman, we have the whole world collapsed. And the second stage was a stage of sudden awareness. Suddenly, all those who have been denying what was going on, at least some of them began to realize that something was seriously wrong. The famous Greenspan deposition to the US Congress, where he said that the whole model that he had in mind was basically had been proven wrong, was the governor of the Bank of England saying that they were so obsessed by inflation targeting that they forgot to look at anything else. We have the report of the Central Bank of Germany saying that at that time, toxic asset of banks, German banks, were $1 trillion. And basically, in other words, there was a second period in which suddenly it looked like the mania had gone and people were reconnecting with the real world, okay? But unfortunately, it didn't last very long. Very soon, there was all this reinterpretation. It was all about labor rigidities. It's all about uncontrolled immigration in Europe. It's all about excessive regulation. It's all about these liberals. Remember the famous law that in the US forces some financial institutions to lend to low-income people, the 97 law. Suddenly, it's all about the governments. In other words, what is clear is that people cannot hold on in a sustainable way with such threatening type of realities, okay? Because the whole ideology is basically being challenged. The whole way of thinking is basically being challenged. And suddenly, it's all about China. I mean, what can happen in this world that's not China's fault? I mean, I'm sure if England does badly in the European Cup, it's going to be China's fault. And what China, because they have this huge level of reserves, this was all the Asian savings glut, including China. And this was the value of the world. The red one is the value of the stock of financial asset. Really, $3 trillion were responsible for that value of financial asset doubling from 125 to 250 trillion. That would be a nice multiplier. In other words, basically, you have these unbelievable explanations re-emerging after the period of where people begin to be a little bit more sensible. And we have, of course, for example, the Bloomberg saying that all was the fault of Congress. We have Steve Forbes saying that all what we have to do is to shrink governments and inequality and jobless will disappear. We have Larry Summers saying that how could it be that AIG was not regulated? That was outrageous. This is the same Summers who had been the one who opposed the regulation of derivative markets when he was Treasury Secretary in the US in 98. And I got the vote when he says that all this party to this kind of contracts, derivatives, are largely sophisticated financial institutions that would appear to be eminently capable of protecting themselves from fraud and counterparty insolvency. I should submit that the proponents of such regulation, basically Brooklyn Bond, are the ones that must produce their. I mean, the same guy who had been the main person opposing regulation of derivative markets, how could it be that AIG was not regulated? That is outrageous. I mean, in this third stage, it's unbelievable how people begin again to be completely detached from reality and their own realities, and they begin to interpret crises like that. Greece, and now the same one who said that his core model of thinking was wrong, now saying that no, it's all about 100-year events, it's all about chance, it's all about just happen. I mean, how can you regulate financial market after this crisis if only happens 100 years? I mean, obviously, doesn't make any sense. Okay, so basically, and of course, my favorite quote is from the British Chancellor, and you have to read it, is this. As the storms of the Eurozone crisis gather, there is risk that the good work we have done in Britain during the last 20 years in building a stable financial sector is unwound. The first bank run for 50 years took place in Britain. The first major bank that went bust was Britain. It took place in Britain. I mean, so be careful with all this reinterpretation of the crisis. Okay? Because obviously the policy prescriptions that one needs to do to avoid this type of situation is one that has been completely lost in the debates, certainly in the debates in Europe. And my final point is that on top of regulation, on top of doing what you need to do in your financial market here, I think it's clearly, going back to my first point, the vulnerability that you have in South Africa, in your current account, in your trade account, in your capital, I mean, you have to do something, and this is certainly part true for my part of the world, Latin America, in order to restructure your economy to be less vulnerable to this kind of shocks. And there is the obvious point is there is something seriously wrong going on with Latin American and South African manufacturing sector. And the main reason of the trade account being what it is the high income elasticity of imports of manufacturers. I mean, it's not a big surprise about that. I mean, if you look at the BRICS, look at what's happening in manufacturing since 1965. This is basically the sum of the total manufacturing production, what percentage was responsible for each one. Brazil, up to 1980, had the value of manufacturing output equal to China, India, and South Africa. Today is about 10% of the total. Look at South Africa, how you have been losing your shares. And obviously, a key point here is what happened with productivity. If you look at the productivity gap of the US, South Africa vis-a-vis the US, and in 1970, whatever that difference was, you make it 100. So if the line goes down, you are falling behind. And if the line goes up, you are catching up with US's productivity, okay? Look at manufacturing, the blue one. Going downhill all the way. If anything, since 94, the slowdown has been slowed down. You are falling behind has been slowed down. But today, your productivity is half, vis-a-vis the US, is half what it was in 1970. Or the US productivity is twice as much vis-a-vis what it was in 1970. And the US is not a particularly dynamic manufacturing sector, okay? So when you talk about what's happening in your deindustrialization, this graph, I think, very briefly, tells a lot of story. I follow methodology of somebody sitting in this room, which basically tells me of the fall of the manufacturing employment, how much is due to productivity, how much is due to the share of manufacturing sector, and how much is due to what's happening in the rest of the economy. All I want to say is the following. Look at how much is the fall on your manufacturing employment since 94. Everybody else is 80, but you 94, to have the period of the answer. It's almost identical to Korea. And I read a lot of people arguing about that. That South African interest is not different from Korea, and getting really interesting conclusion from that. Yes, but the Korean one is due to a massive increase in productivity in manufacturing, which of course reduces employment, being compensated by an increase in the share of manufacturing in GDP, and compensated by an increase in the overall productivity of the economy. So although the results are the same, in your case, you're neither having much productivity change in manufacturing, neither much change in the manufacturing sector in GDP, neither much change in the productivity of the overall economy. Meaning, your deindustrialization is mostly a kind of, very much like the rest of Latin America, okay? I'm not talking anything which is different from my part of the world. It's mostly a manufacturing sector which is in some sort of hibernation. It's a sort of defensive position. basically nothing very dramatic is happening. Look at the case of Asia. Okay? So even if the results would be the same, the forces that produce that industrialization are massively different. Okay? So if you want to have an economy which is not so vulnerable, I mean, if you have to live with an international economy as psychotic as the one that you unfortunately have to live with, well, it goes without saying that you have to have a domestic economy that somehow is protected from there, from the capital account to your manufacturing sector. An economy that can withstand this kind of massive negative effects that you get from the rest of the world. So, just to summarize briefly, because I have more than just my time. First, remember, your current account not only is 3% deficit, and the normal commodity prices would be 9% deficit, okay? So, there you have a bit of a time bomb. And if commodity prices readjust, which I don't expect it to be soon, because unfortunately, depending on the point of view, commodity prices suddenly are behaving counter-cyclical. Commodity prices that was the most pro-cyclical variable on Earth, because of financial speculation, they have become anti-cyclical. So somehow that obviously helps, but don't count on that taking it lasting a very long time. Next issue, your mining sector, your export competitor. I mean, there is a big issue that you have to deal with, okay? Next one, be very careful, be very aware, be very suspicious on every policy prescription that is emerging around the world as a result of this crisis, okay? It's unbelievable how people can turn a blind eye to what is in front of their face and begin, in England, they're having a field day. It's all the fault of Europe. I mean, is there anything more popular in Great Britain than to blame Europe for everything that goes wrong? I mean, it's all about immigrants. It's all about labor rigidity. I mean, I was reading yesterday a report from the IMF about Spain. It's all about wages in the public sector. Of course, wages in the public sector was making the stock of financial assets grow at 25% per year in Spain, of course. Of course. I mean, be very aware that at least the reading of the crisis that is taking place at the moment is something that is beyond belief. I mean, it's nothing like what happened in the 30s with Roosevelt, who at least were reading things as they were happening, let alone Keynes in the 50s, okay? And finally, you have to aim at an economy. I don't mean a closed economy. I don't mean a return to the past. I don't mean anything of that kind. But you have to have an economic structure that is not so vulnerable to portfolio flows and to deindustrialization. Under those conditions, you will, because believe me, my main prediction is that when in 20 years' time, those of you who are still around, will look back, and this crisis will be remembered, not so much for how bad it was, but for how long it lasted, for how long it took for the world economy to come out of this crisis. So, under those conditions, you have to have an economic structure which is more, have better foundations, in terms of more able to resist those negative shocks that you are continuing to have from abroad for quite a bit of time, on your capital account, on your domestic structure, and so on. Thank you very much.